Hello, this is Jitte Wagen, and this is the fourth and final screencast in a series of screencasts in which I will be introducing relational databases and Microsoft Access 2016. Okay, and this final screencast will be about the creation and designing of forms. Now, this will be a relatively short screencast because forms is a very extensive subject. There are many possibilities and ways to make them into very sophisticated tools for data entry and retrieval, but that would be going through all of that would be beyond the scope of this introductory course. So I will be dealing with this relatively quickly, showing you how you can create a form for this the training database we've been working with, and giving you some anchors and directions for elaborating on the design and functionality. Okay, so what is a form? A form is best regarded as a user interface to your database or to a set of tables in your database. And you can use them to make entering data into multiple tables at once as easy as possible. They shield complexity of database tables and relationships from the user. And as I mentioned before, they allow you to create a whole range of custom functionality to the interaction with your database. Okay, so before we start, I should say that there are two types of forms in Microsoft Access. You have bound forms and unbound forms. Bound forms are directly connected to your database tables. So they are a window onto your tables and they allow you to enter the data, to view the data, etc., etc. Unbound forms, on the other hand, are not directly related, not directly linked to your tables, but they exist and can be created to make available a range of buttons, command buttons, as they are called in Microsoft Access, which allow functionality, batch processes, etc., etc. In this screencast, I will only be dealing with bound forms, and I'm actually going to make it very simple and show you how to use the form wizard to create a form based on our two tables. Okay, so we continue working with the database that we ended with in the last screencast. For those who step in at this moment, this is the HALOS 2012 Training Database 2, which I placed on my desktop, and we can work directly with this. Well, in order to start with the form wizard, we go to Create, and here you can see that we have in the fourth box on the ribbon, we have here form, form design, blank form, and form wizard with some more options over here. Now, as I said, I will be using the form wizard, so I'll click on that. Okay, so this dialog box appears, and this box allows us to define which fields from which table or query do we want to add to our form. So we see here tables queries, and we can select tables or queries with using the arrow. Now we have the table tracts over here, and you can see that the available fields change according to the table that you select in the upper part of the screen. Now what I want is actually to have all the fields from tracts on my form. And I also want all the fields from the table results on my form. And then I will click Next. Okay, then the form wizard will now ask us how we would like to view our data. Now, just to recall, what do we have with these two tables? We have tracts, and in tracts, in every individual tract, which is a single record in the table, results are collected. So results has a many-to-one relationship with the table tracts, This is defined by placing the tract ID, which is the primary key of the table tracts, as a foreign key in the table results. And this is the relationship that we defined with the referential integrity, etc. And what we are now asked actually, and what this form wizard does, is it takes this relationship directly into account. So it can deduce from the structure that we have that actually our results are we can have many results listed to a single tract, and therefore it places already proposes results to be a subform, which is indeed excellent in what we want. So we accept this and we click next. We are asked what layout we would like to have for our subform. So do we want a tabular or a data sheet? Well, we'll leave it at data sheet and you will see how that looks like. We click next, and then we can change whether we want to have different or we can change the title. So we can set the title of our forms over here. I'm very fine with the current titles, and then we can either open the form to enter information or go directly into the form design and start modifying. Now we'll leave it at this and click finish, and we can see that now immediately our form appears. Okay, so what do we have now? I'll maximize this. What we have now is this form over here, in which we can see that the columns from the table tract have been inserted as a set of fields, with the column headers here, the names of the fields as names on the form, and then we have here the entry fields which have been adjusted according to the field, the data type of the field. So notes fields will be automatically be larger than simple text fields, etc. And you can see that the outlining is still consistent with the data type, either number of text. And in addition, we see the insertion here of a subform in a data sheet view, in which we actually see the records as we are already familiar with from the data sheet view of the results table itself. Now, very important to point out now is that the results table over here now only shows the records that are associated to the tract with tract ID number one. And this is what I meant before when I said the relationship is taken into account and is incorporated. So you will only see data that actually belongs together. Okay, now before we start fine-tuning this form, I should point out that here in the shutter bar we now indeed see also we can ask for the group forms. What I could also do now is just click on all access objects, and then you will see everything that we've been creating so far. So the two tables, the query, and now our forms. And we have here now form tools as well that we can use to work with the forms. Okay, so there are already some things you can do to refine the form directly in this view. So for example, this result ID is an automatically generated number that actually bears no meaning to the data that we have, other than that it is a fundamental piece of information to link the tables together. So what we can do here is we can simply hide the field, because we are basically not really interested in it. And the same goes for the tract ID, which is the foreign key in the results table that directly connects these results to this tract. But we can trust in this relationship, and we can just hide the field so we are not bothered with the information. And what we remain with is the information that actually matters to us as archaeologists, as the users of this database. Okay, now what you can also see here is that we have navigation bars. And these navigation bars actually function in the same way as the navigation bar works for our data in a data sheet view in the tables. So what we can do is we can just go on to the next record, we can go to the last record, we can even create a new record, and I will come back to data entry in a bit. But this is very easy to navigate through our data, and what we can see, which should by now be rather obvious, is that if we change from one track to another, the results, so the data in the results table changes with it. So it just keeps on switching to the relevant subset of records. So as I just said, these forms are very useful, not only for looking at your data and browsing through your records, but they're also very useful for the entry of data. So let's demonstrate this, and we can do that, for example, by going to the navigation bar of our main form, the tracks form, and we then hit this this arrow with this this star over here, so to create a new blank record. I will enter some data. Remember that we had for track ID, we had a number field, not an auto number field, so we actually have to manually insert that. We can change it, of course, to auto number field now, but it's fine the way it is. So I use tab to browse through the record, the fields. So if I hit tab, it will jump to the next one. And the way that the tab navigates us through the form, you can completely fine tune that. But it's now automatically set to follow the order of the order of columns in the original table. And you can see here with date that we now have this little widget, which is automatically activated if you enter that field. Yeah, I'll just enter the current date, and so on and so forth. So we created this new record, and let's enter some results over here. So let's do it. So someone found a lot more than someone else. And let's say, yeah, we had three results and this is fine. Now there are two things that I want to point out now. So first of all, this data is now automatically saved in our table. If we look in the tables, we can see now, well, if you have the table still open, you need to close it and open it again to refresh the data, but indeed we have now a track ID 21 with the data that I just entered. And if we look at the results table, we can also see that we have the same thing here. Let's open results. We have here these three records that I just entered. And what's the most important thing to point out here is that you can see that this track ID has been set to 21. In other words, the relationship has already been satisfied in the sense that these foreign keys relating to the primary key of the tracked table is automatically entered, and that's of course a very, very useful aspect to these forms. If you use them for entry, is that you can take away the burden of making sure that these relationships are respected, and that there's no risk of creating orphan records in the results table, for example, because this is automatically taken care of, and that's of course a very powerful feature. Okay, so this is just very quickly on how you can create with a few clicks on a button, a form that is actually quite useful, how it works. And I just want to finish this screencast by pointing out how you can start making changes to a form to further optimize it and fine-tune it for your own needs. Okay, and the way to go about it is to change the view of the form. So as you would have expected by now, that all these database objects always have different views that you can call for. So for example, the forms have the form view, which is what we are looking at, layout view and design view. Well, both layout and design view allow you to make modifications. And the important, the main difference between the two is that layout view maintains the direct link to your data. So you can still go through your data and use the form as for which it is designed to do. But you are able to change mainly stuff related to layout. So what we could do, for example, is to make this bigger or smaller. We can also do that with individual boxes if we would want to make the notes field much larger. We can change the order of fields. So if you want to have one field on another location, we could do that. What you see is that what appeared here to the right is a fields list. So we can now, depending on what form we selected. So remember, we had the main form and the subform, and you can see that the fields change according to the form that we select. And we now selected the results form. Let's say that we do, after all, find it useful to have tracked ID visible in our little subform over here. So we could then just drag and drop the field back into the results table, so we can still access and access the data directly. So yeah, the layout view allows you to do that while still retaining this direct link to your data. And then the design view breaks the link, so you get the form as a totally loose object. You're not looking at your data anymore, with of course the disadvantages that you cannot resize your interface elements based on, for example, the length of values entered in fields. But on the other hand, you get a lot more functionality and possibilities to change your forms and optimize and add functionality. So if we really go into the form design, then we also have to change the current adaptations that we made to these forms. So that would be, again, of course, these are two forms in terms of database objects. So we say yes, and then the changes are recorded to both. And now we see actually the design view that allows us to do many more things. Now, as I said, I won't go through all of them. I just want to show you the degree of freedom that you have here to do things. You can see that we now have, for example, a division in form header and the detail. If we would say, well, we don't even want a header, actually, we can just switch it off, and then it will also delete all controls in them, and then with controls it means buttons and stuff like that. So we are fine with deleting that, and now we can see that we do not have this header anymore, which can be nice, but actually most of the time just takes up space. We can do all kinds of things here. Of course, we can still also do this whole rearrangement of items on our form. But one of the I will show two important points where you can start thinking about more advanced design. What you can do, for example, is to call for the properties of a specific form. So now we're clicking on this box here in the left upper part of the tracked form, I can call for the properties of that form. The same goes for the results table. I can click on that little square box over there, and then I get the property sheet related to that form. Now, what can we do here? So this property sheet shows us a whole range of properties of the form, and we can use all these options here. We can refine and fine tune this how we want it. So this format is about the way this form is visually presented. So you can have all options here, like we could make this into different forms. This is where you could, for example, also change this to data sheet. Remember, this option was also presented for the subform during the form wizard. We can allow or not allow a data sheet view, so that when someone else is using it that has no access to the design interface, that we can also make sure that he or she can change to data sheet view, and yeah, you have here all kinds of options about pictures and width and center, navigation buttons, record selectors. Well, you can, for example, let's shut down the record selectors and the navigation buttons. Let's take a look what the effect is. Now, there was this record selector over here. If you remember, there's a bar with an arrow that is something that you actually barely use in this form layout. And so we now switch that off. On the other hand, we now also have no navigation anymore, which is, of course, not really handy. But in any case, so this property sheet allows you to modify the form. Then we have all the properties related to the data. So we can set here the record source so that actually you could change here where this form looks for the data that is displayed. We now have here a dynaset, but it can also be a snapshot. We wanted to fetch details. There are still filter in place. I see I could remove that and so on and so forth. Now then we have the event part tab in the property sheet, and that allows us to enter a huge range of triggered behavior. So we can say if this form loads, we want something to happen, and we can then go on and enter a micro builder, or we can go into an expression builder, or we can even start scripting. So you can just script events that if that form starts, that maybe a warning is presented, or a window with some vital information, or maybe you want to run a check on data integrity if you load the form or whatever. I mean, you can think of uses on your own, but on any kind of event, so when you press a key, if you click on the form, when you on dirty, I believe that's when you make any move at all. When you are focused on the form, on mouse move, on key up, well, and so on and so forth. So you can use all these actions, these events that take place when you are interacting with the form, as moments to attach macros or your own scripts to. And then finally, you have the tab other with a few options that were not easily to organize in other tabs. Okay, so this is all related to the form and its properties, but as I said, you can also add items to the forms yourself that actually can activate a function or a script or whatever. So what we see here in the form design tools, we have three tabs, which is design, arrange, and format. And if we go into the design tab, we can see here a whole range of items that we can insert. So we can insert checkboxes, we can insert, we could use this if we would, for example, have another subform displaying other information that would be related many to one. We can create that table, we can define the relationship, and then use this button to actually insert that subform here and make sure it works the way we want it to work. We can enter a text box, we can make labels and so on and so forth. We can also make a tab control, so we actually insert a tabbed control in our form. So if we would have two subforms, we could actually organize them to behave as two tabs of one and single item, which is of course useful to save space. But just in order to give you a very simple example of what you can do with all these controls, I want to use this one and insert a button into our form. Okay, so let's do this. And with the option button selected, I will drag the shape of the button where I want to insert it. You can see that it is given a text which relates to the property sheet that appeared here that is now connected to this specific button, and it's now being called command 21. And what you can see here is that you have now this command button wizard that asks us if we want to use any of these default actions. So we can just choose from different categories, and then within categories there are different actions that are available by default. So we could indeed say, well, I want to go to the next record. So let's do that. So I in the category of record navigation, go to next record. Do I want to have a nice picture as an or yeah, let's do that. So there are different options available, and you can see the preview over here. And I will say, yeah, maybe I will give it a name that's more easy to remember in case I want to use this button also to attach other scripts to. And then I hit finish, and then as simple as that, we have a button on our form that actually does something. And let's take a look at it in the form view. And indeed, we have here now this button, and if I would click on it, you see that it actually navigates us through the records. Now, of course, you may wonder, why would you enter such a button when you have this this navigation bar over here? Well, let's suppose that it is essential for your data that some check or some control action or some script, to be general about it, is executed the moment you skip to a new record. So maybe there's going to be some very advanced validation script on the data that you want to run at that moment. We can, apart from the fact that this button brings us to the next record, we can attach script to it as well. And this is something that you could not do, cannot do with this built-in navigation toolbar. So what we then could do is to indeed, as I just did as an example, switch off the default navigation bar, recreate all the functionality that we have here through these adding these buttons that we made ourselves, but then also attach scripts to make the buttons do a bit more to optimize the our workflow. So if we would go back to the design view, as I said, indeed now the button has its own property sheet. It's now called next record, and again we can set here a whole range of events for it. We can add all kinds of functionality. So the current functionality is tied to the on click, so the moment you click the button something happens. But you can also for example make sure that the button already, that there's an event attached at the moment that you get this button into focus. And if you would tap through the field, then you would go to the fields, but also you will focus on each subsequent button. So if that for some reason would be useful, you could do that. Now then, let's take a quick look at the event procedure that we now attach to the on click. And if we click on that, you can see that we actually are in a user interface to directly code in Microsoft Visual Basic for Applications. So we have here a private sub, an error procedure, and we have a do command function that is attached to this record. Now, this is far outside the scope of this introductory course. I'm just showing this to make it clear that this is the way you can attach your own script. Yeah, if you know Visual Basic, you can insert code here to make this do something, display something, or what have you. And this would be the place to start actually doing that type of coding. For now, I will just switch this off. Yeah, and with this demonstration first part of the screencast, how you can create the form, and in the second part, what ways you have for manipulating the layout, creating events, and inserting controls on forms. I've come to the end of this short final screencast on relational database of Microsoft Access 2016. And I hope this is useful for your own endeavors. So I thank you for watching and listening.